All right, next question is, I've been having problems with head pressure when I deadlift. It seems to be less when I focus on my hips. Any tips on mitigating this? All right, look, so most people, if they're having head pressure, now you should be having head pressure down when you're in the bottom of the deadlift. Like if you're on your setup and you're getting ready to pull, there should be immense head pressure at that moment, but should actually relieve as the weight goes up and you get the lockout. But I'm gonna go ahead and assume that we're not talking about that. We're talking about head pressure for the entire thing. And what that probably means is that you're focusing your air into your face. A lot of people can brace. You can put your air in different areas of your body, right? Like some people put their air down. Some people put their air in their chest. Some people put their air in their face. And those people, typically when you brace, your face will instantly start turning more and more red, more and more red, more and more red. Like you're like a petulant child. All that you need to do is refocus that air downward. And when you said you're focusing on your hip, what's probably happening is that you're constantly thinking down and you're just focusing that air downward towards your hips more. What I want you to think about when you get your big belly breath of air, do not go up here, do not go into your face. Think about filling up your belly, filling up that cavity as much as possible, but then don't only stop there. Most people fill up their belly and then they start trying to fill up their chest. Fill up your belly and then fill up your obliques. Once you fill up your obliques, start filling up your lower back. Fill up around your spine. Try to think about like an entire inner tube all the way around you, just filling up, filling up, filling up, but that's the only inner tube. Nothing else is going up or down. Then brace that downward. Some people brace downward towards the back and they have some bathroom problems, and some people brace towards the front and they have other bathroom problems, but if you're not bracing downward, then it's going to be going up in your face. It's all about where you put that air, man. I hope that helps you out and I hope that your head feels better. All right, next question is, favorite assistance item for around the mid lockout? Like you get stuck around mid zone. My personal favorite is the double pause deadlift. So I like to pause the deadlift 1 inch off the ground and then 1 inch below my knee and then stand up. And they're both very distinct pause. You guys have seen me pause before. I don't like, oh, I paused. I pause, right? So I pause like a 1-2 count, stand up to about an inch below my knees, 1-2 count, stand the rest of the way up. I think those for that mid shin area have done more for me than anything. Also banded deadlifts, kind of learn how to build momentum through that sticking point. However, that's still my sticking point. So if I had a better answer, I probably wouldn't have that sticking point. I hope that helps you. I guess it's only helped me to some extent. All right, next question. Tips on how to engage hamstrings and butt more. Feel like you have decent form, but it's always your back that's sore and not your legs after. Well, first thing, man, if your back is sore and not your legs after deadlift, it probably just means that you're lifting more with your back. In reality, the deadlift is more of a back exercise than a leg exercise, or even more of a core exercise than really a back exercise. But so it's not rare for people's legs to be less sore than their back. So that's not a strange thing. However, first part of your question, how to engage your hamstring and butt more. So what I personally like to do is throw, you guys know how I like to throw the antagonistic muscle group before the main muscle mover in a lot of my movements. And for the deadlift and squat especially, I like to throw explosive movements instead of that antagonistic movement before the main muscle mover. And what that's for is to get my hips moving explosively. And what that essentially means is hips is synonymous with butt in most weightlifting communities, right? So what I'm trying to do is get my butt moving through that path as quickly as possible, which is what you're talking about. Two things I think will help you. Number one is either get a hip circle from Slingshot, where you wrap that around your knees and you do kind of side straddle walks with a band around your knees, because that's going to load up your glutes as part of your warm-up or even between your sets. If you don't want to spend money on a hip circle, you can just double up resistance bands and do that same thing. But then also what I want you to do is take a heavy resistance band or an average resistance band, stand on it, throw it around your neck, and do good mornings. Now, before you do these good mornings, what I want you to do is get, you're gonna have to bend over to get the use your words, over top your neck. And when you get down in that bent over position, make sure that you're pushing your butt back so the band stays over top of the middle of your foot. But once you're in that bent over butt push back position, I want you to flex your butt and your hamstrings, because they should already be kind of wound up in that bottom position, a little bit of a stretch. So you should be able to focus on them a little bit more. Now, explosively stand up like you're doing a good morning. Hold on to those bands. Don't stand up so explosively that that band will rip your feet out from underneath you, because that will happen. But stand up explosively and flex your glutes as hard as possible in the top, like you're locking out a deadlift. Now push your butt back like you're lowering the bar. Stand up explosively again. Focus on your butt and your hamstrings that entire time while you're doing that. Do that right before you pull. So that would be your antagonistic muscle mover, your explosive muscle movement before your deadlift. So you do that, to your deadlift, to some sort of core exercise, spin it again, do it again. Doing that is going to just help you fire and recognize that mind-muscle connection to your glutes and your hamstrings so that when it moves over a deadlift, you should be able to feel it a little bit more, hopefully starting to activate it and use it, but also that hip circle trick at the beginning as part of your warm-up will also just make your butt kind of feel like it has knots in it, which is gonna make you think about it more when you're doing the movements anyway. I hope that helps you out. Thank you very much for asking. All right, next question. I can RDL 405 off racks, but off the floor, that's tough. Brother, the very first question I answered about the videoing yourself on the side and doing the reverse engineering, do that because your deadlift is not right. That is why it's so much harder. You're strong enough to do it. It's not a muscle thing at all. It's that your setup is no good. You need to fix your hip position or whatever else is going wrong. But the only way that you're going to do that is by assessing that form to the side like I talked about in the very first question. Thank you very much. It'll definitely help, man. All right, next question. Touch and go versus dead stop. So I think it depends on the athlete, what their goals are and what their sport is. I think if you're a strong man, touch and go is far greater because it's about time under tension, right? And so many things in strongman are about time under tension because most of the time you're working for 60 seconds and it is extremely, extremely hard. And the biggest thing it starts giving is your endurance. It's not your power output, right? So I think for strongman, 100% touch and go, I believe, is better. For a powerlifter, I would highly say stop dead stop reps because you need to practice like you play, right? There could be an argument for powerlifters that they should do nothing but singles because that's all that they're really tested in. Now, granted, you need to talk about overall strength and, again, time under tension to build muscularity and things like that. But as far as actual technique, why do more than singles for powerlifters? I mean, that's what they're practicing. Now, strongman, it's a completely different game, so that's why I think touch and go is better. But I think if you're going to build mass, I believe touch and go is 1,000% better for building mass. Personal opinion, a lot of people disagree with that. That's what I think. So that's what I said. Thanks very much for the question, bro. Next question. Do you think eccentric deadlifts with above maximal weight would be a good way to increase your deadlift, or would it be too taxing on the body? I think it depends on what type of Mexican supplements you might be taking or what your maximal weight is. So if like your deadlift is 225 and you want to do that with 315, sure. If your deadlift is 800 pounds and you want to do that 900 pounds, I'd say be careful, but thanks for the question. Next question, should my deadlift stance and my squat clean stance be the same? Absolutely not, man. Your hips are gonna do two completely different things throughout that movement. I would not make them the same. That might be a good starting point as a reference point if you're learning how to squat clean, but that's gonna greatly change as you try to, you know, tie in either your deadlift form or your squat clean form. One of the two is absolutely going to start to be different. Just two different animals, man. Thank you very much for the question. How do you feel about a grip and rip type setup, also known as no reel setup? You say that you can pull more like this, but you spend a long time in your setup, then it gets in your head. So, much like I talked about earlier, I think you should set up a type of ritual. Every single time that you go up to a deadlift bar from 135 to 225, however high you're going, every single set, no matter what's going on, you approach the bar the exact same way and you do your setup the exact same way. This way, it becomes almost second nature. Your mind and your body kind of working together, kind of on a different plane where all that kind of stuff is handled. You're not wondering if you're gonna walk up and scream. You're not gonna walk up and stomp your feet. Whatever's gonna happen, all that's already taken care of. All you're focused on is three cues, right? For me personally, those cues are like squeeze the bar, push the floor, accelerate the bar. Those might be my three cues, right? If your setup is taking too long and starts getting in your head, it's because you haven't spent enough time on the setup. Right now, I know you say that the grip it, rip it will definitely work for you, and that is great, man. The problem is, as you get bigger and bigger and stronger, there's a reason why not one world record holder or top level strongman or top level anybody does the grip it and rip it method, man. Everyone needs that type of, it needs to be perfect, man. You're talking about leverages, and an inch is gonna be the difference of getting your lift or not. And if you're just doing a grip or a rip it, that's not gonna matter. So I'm guessing if you're not really working weights that are substantial enough to either hurt you or that you can't overcome if you do something messed up. So I would tell you, take the time to become a tactician, man. Strength is a skill, and the only way you get better at a skill is practice. Good, mindful practice, not just getting through it. Learn your setup, get it exact, make it the same every single time, no matter what, so that then, no matter how amped you are, or whether you're in front of 10,000 people doing this deadlift, or it's a PR, or it's just a regular set, it doesn't matter. Your body's going to do the same thing, and it's not gonna get any extra signals that are gonna throw it off and start giving it bad signals to make it not perform at its optimal level, right? Learn it, teach it a ritual so you walk up, you do the same thing every single time, and then you can grip it and rip it all you want, because your grip it and rip it is literally going to be your setup. If you do not choose to do that, then the grip it and rip it is eventually going to get to a point where it's just not going to work anymore. It's exactly like when you're 18 and you have all this rage and you think that rage is going to be there forever and you're going to be able to use it. Unfortunately, that goes away. But same thing here, man. You're relying on something that is a very short live that you're getting away with because you're probably pretty good and you probably have a lot of potential to be great. But you'll never get to great if you keep settling for good, man. So become great by putting in the work, put in the effort, learn that setup, and I promise you, you'll be so much happier you did and probably a lot more injury-free along the way. Thank you very much for your question. Thanks for asking it. All right, next question. Top five deadlifters who are strongman, bro. I know I'm involved in strongman, and I know a lot of strongman just through this whole wild, crazy ride that is my life, but I don't actually follow it. I don't watch it. I watch it to see how certain people did, and just see how they performed and try to learn how they do things. But I don't really know anything as far as that goes. I don't know people's stats. I don't know how good they are, where they rank, things like that. I just, I know them as people. And I have no idea. I'm sorry, man. All right, next question is, I have a physical job. How do I deadlift without getting screwed over so much by having to do so much physical labor? And I actually responded to you and asked you, how old are you? Because that's going to greatly vary how I answer this question. If you're my age, that's tough, man. That's going to come down to good programming because you just don't have as much juice in the tank as you once did. At your age, you're 19. Bro, what you have right there is a gift. When I was coming up, my dad owned a construction company, so my summers and my weekends and everything else was spent doing construction, where I spent hammering, carrying lumber, digging holes, doing whatever needed to be done, right? I was just a mass laborer, and I was literally working out probably 5-6 days a week. Every day, just try. I didn't know what I was doing. Back then, we didn't have the internet. We didn't have the opportunity to learn these things the way you guys do. We literally were just trying everything we could. And I'm telling you, man, the strength that I built doing my manual labor job so much greatly helped my weight training career that I would never, ever, ever replace that with anything else. What you have there is a gift, man. Work as hard as you can at your job and then work as hard as you can at the gym. Trust me, the type of stuff that you are doing is the absolute perfect thing that you can do for assistance or anything else. You are in the best possible situation. If you are a young man and you're complaining about not being able to do whatever physically, get a manual labor job for the summers, on the weekends, whatever. I promise you, stuff will start coming up in you and you'll start to build man muscles. A lot of you saw my dad recently on his 66th birthday, just in November, pulled 475 pounds and he's only been lifting for about a year. Now, a lot of people are gonna say genetics or whatever, but I will tell you exactly what that is. He's done construction for 40 years of his life. The man is hammered. And I tell you, when I was coming up and I was lifting and I was a strong young man, he still could keep up with me with absolutely everything. We carried ridiculously heavy things and he was never the one saying, not me, man, I can't handle it. Because he had spent all those years doing those things. This is the greatest opportunity you have, man. Do not look at it as a negative. If anything, man, push harder into that job. Trust me, the muscles that you're building there will so greatly carry over into your lifting career. You know how I can move faster and more explosively and do things that other people can't do? It's because I was spending time doing those things that you're doing instead of spending time in the gym trying to do nothing but the workout stuff, man. You are building real muscle that is going to translate into so much more strength and so much cooler athletic stuff if you continue to do it. Do not look at it as a downside, man. Awesome, awesome thing. Keep doing it. I'm so pumped for you. This is gonna be good. Thank you for your question, man. To be 19 again. They have lots of questions. What do you want me to do about it? They have lots of questions.
Okay, we'll answer this one together.
All right, next question says, I can't deadlift for reps. After each rep, I have to rebrace or my core will get wobbly and my head dizzy. Any tips or ideas? Everyone has to rebrace for each rep. I'm confused. So what I would tell you is get that very first breath and try to get as many reps as possible on that breath. Then when you don't have any air left or you know you don't have enough air to complete another rep, stand at the top in lockout position because your body is in biomechanical strength position there. You're not gonna fall over in lockout, right? If you're not in lockout, you're gonna fall over because you're not braced. From there, get a lot of air, brace down again, reach down, touch the ground, stand back up, reach down, touch ground, stand back up. When you need more air, do the same thing again. But re-brace at the top of the rep, and when you're in lockout, make sure your butt flexed. If your butt is not flexed and your posterior chain is not fired, at which time that bar is controlling you, you're not controlling the bar. But honestly, man, everyone needs to rebreathe and rebrace all the time when they're deadlifting for reps. Some people need to do it every rep or every other rep. Some people get away with 5 reps, then 3 reps, then rep. Whatever it's gonna be different for you and your different lung capacity and your capacity to actually have the tolerance to handle that level of head pressure. But man, get that air up top, it's gonna make a massive difference. All right, next question is, I'm in a 365 deadlift and I wanna get to 4 plates. What should the deadlift frequency be and what should I vary my intensities? Bro, if any of you out there are between like a, let's say 365 and like a 455 deadlift, if you're in that range anywhere, just pick a program, a pretty basic program, and stick to it, man. Because at that stage, you're still in a very great place for growing, right? Once you get above 455, you start inching towards 500, things start to slow down, you need to pay a little bit more attention to your programming. But for most full-grown adult males, or at least, you know, teenage to adult males, getting up to a 455 deadlift is going to be a weight that's very doable for almost everyone if they put in the time and effort with reasonably good programs. Once it gets above that, you need to start playing with the kind of frequency and the intensity a little bit more, because you're gonna get into some CNS demands just because the heavier weights of the deadlifts. But for right now, man, pick a program, stick to it. You're gonna do awesome, trust me. Hit me back up when you're 455. Great thing's gonna happen. Sorry about the dogs fighting. Next question is, don't really resort to straps. So question would be, any lotions or creams to help with proper hand care? So dude, I did an entire video about this. I would not be sticking any lotions or creams in your hands. If you want to, go ahead. Not my thing. What I did put out was a video about when your calluses are getting built up, how to break them down. Also, if you do tear a callus, how to actually properly deal with it, how to taper your hand so you continue training, because a torn callus can literally put you out for weeks. It's not worth it all. You need to take care of your hands so they can take care of you. I did an entire video on it. Make sure you check that out. Just search Brian Alsruhe hand care for powerlifters and strongmen. Thank you very much. I hope they answered your question. All right, so a lot of you asked about sumo. Why I don't do it, why no one at my gym does it. Here's the thing, people. Sumo is not allowed in strongman. So my gym is primarily a strongman gym where almost everyone competes in strongman. So there's just not a whole lot of carryover from sumo deadlift over to conventional deadlift. There is a little bit, don't get me wrong, you'll get a little bit over, I would say you get more carryover from conventional deadlift over to sumo deadlift. But for our sport, there's absolutely no time in the world when you're spreading your legs way out in an unathletic position, trying to shorten the range of motion as much as possible to lift more weight. I have absolutely no problem with powerlifters doing that because that is their game. Their game is see who can move the most weight as possible within these rules. I am all about them getting as much bench arch as possible, as much sumo deadlifts as possible. I do not consider cheating because that is what they do. I would, people consider what we do cheating because we're allowed to hitch the bar. In strongman, it doesn't matter, man. You get from point A to point B, you move that weight in that direction, it gets there. As ugly as it is, no matter how you got it there, it counts. I personally like that. But the powers that be a long time ago decided that sumo was not athletic enough to be part of strongman, so they took it out. That's why you never see any of us training it. Also, the fact that there's not a whole lot of carryover in other strongman implements and other events. And for me personally, the whole train to be dangerous thing, I don't do sumo because, I mean, how many times in my life do I do an athletic thing with my legs spread out like that? It doesn't really happen. The conventional deadlift could be converted over into literally picking anything up in real life, as well as like an explosive forward motion. The sumo deadlift is just kind of there to make you move as much weight as possible, which I completely respect, like I said, just not for me. So yeah, I hope that answered the question. Thank you very much for asking it. All right, next question is, I know there's different grips when doing a deadlift, but mostly you see an alternating grip and you use a pronated grip. Does it make a difference? Absolutely, brother. If you're using a pronated grip, you are leaving about 1 billion pounds on the table, right? So you have to think about it like this. If you're holding a barbell in your hands like this and it's heavy, that barbell is gonna fight to unroll both of your fingers, right? And you're not gonna be able to hold much weight because your fingers aren't that strong. Maybe they are, but they're not. So when you flip one hand over, now what happens is the bar has alternating forces. So it's trying to roll this way, and now you can hold it a lot more because you're able to fight that force. That's why I see a lot of people doing it. However, a lot of people cannot lock their lats in as tight like this, so they like using the pronated grip, and that's why you see people using straps. Now, if you don't see people using straps and they're lifting a significant amount of weight, most likely they're not just doing a double overhand grip. Maybe they are, but Most likely not. Most likely what's happening is they're doing a hook grip, which means they're taking their thumb and they're wrapping around the bar and then they're grabbing their thumb. And they're essentially using the bone of their thumb as a strap. Super painful, but super effective. So if you'd like to continue to pull pronated, then I would absolutely recommend that you start using the hook grip, because sooner that you start killing all these nerves in here, the sooner that you're gonna be a happy man again. Or choose to switch to an alternate grip and learn to lock that lat in so you can start moving more weight, because if you're just doing pronated right now, you are doing literally the weakest thing that you could possibly be doing. So great for working your grip, not so great for your deadlift. Thank you very much for asking. That's gonna help a ton. All right, next question. I've always had the issue of my squat being over 600 and my pull being really close to the same weight. Super frustrating considering most people pull 80 to 100 pounds more than their squat. Look, man, here's the issue is you're too strong. As you get stronger, you will find the company around you, not that doesn't continue to happen. Most people's bodies either gravitate more towards the squat or the deadlift. My personal body moves more towards the squat than deadlift because I have these short little T-Rex arms, right? So my deadlift is around the mid sevens and my squat is around the mid sevens. However, my mid seven squat is a lot easier than a mid seven deadlift for me. So as you get stronger and stronger and that starts to kind of gravitate, it's very rare now that you see a top level powerlifter, you know, squatting 800 and pulling 900, or a lot of times the squat will be the high one and the deadlift will be the lower one. Most people's bodies start to gravitate towards more one than the other, and that one starts pulling away eventually, and the other one just kind of starts to stagnate and build a little slower. So unfortunately, man, you might be a better squatter than you are a deadlifter. It just is what it is. It comes down to body type, genetics, a lot of different things, but do not be super frustrated about it. I'm in the exact same boat. Mine are virtually tied. For years, they've been going through a battle of who's gonna win. Right now, my squat's winning. Just is what it is. Next question, I always struggle in the first rep, but the following reps seem to go pretty well. Brother, go back and watch the very first answer to the question about the video from the side and reverse engineering deadlift. That will fix it all. It's that your setup is no good, man. You gotta fix your setup. That's the biggest problem. It's not that you don't have the strength. It's not that you don't have the technique. It's that you don't have the setup. So you need to spend time there, and then that first rep will be as easy as the other ones. Thank you very much for asking. All right, next question. Which deadlift style builds more overall strength, the sumo or conventional? I would have to say conventional. You're using more muscle groups. Next question is, I have trouble keeping a straight back while deadlifting. Any tips? Yes, man, figure out your breathing and bracing. It's not your back, it's your core that's collapsing. So I would highly recommend that you learn how to stick air in there and brace it down. It could be a core weakness issue, or it could be a lot of other issues, but get down that breathing and bracing first, because that most likely is where the problem is. Thank you very much for asking. Next question, have you ever deadlifted in a heel shoe, AKA also like Olympic shoes or squat shoes? Absolutely, man, I don't think it's that big of a deal. It does absolutely throw you forward. I really like doing it on my dynamic effort day with banded deadlifts, simply because it does give you a little bit of deficit, makes it a little bit tougher, throws you forward a little bit, but also since I'm using bands, my pull's not my normal pull at that point anyway, so it just makes it more tough for me. Plus, I just got done doing the dynamic effort squat, so I don't feel like changing my shoes at that point because I'm exhausted. So that's the only time I really use it. Other than that, guys, some people like it, some people do not. Not many people like it, but I do not think it is the deadliest sin that a lot of people make it out to be, like, oh, you're an idiot because you're doing it in your squat. Maybe they like doing it like that. Maybe there's some type of pelvic tilt that allows them to feel better that way. I don't care, man. It's different strokes, different folks. If it makes you happy to do it in your squat shoes, go for it. Most people do not have as good of I guess, progress or results from that. Most people need to be in a flat shoe or even bare feet. For me personally, I go in bare feet or a flat shoe now. But yeah, it is what it is, man. If you want to try it out, try it out. It's not that big of a deal. All right, next question. When it comes to lifting straps versus no lifting straps argument, are you ever worried about tearing your forearm muscles or bicep when not using them? No, man, because you just keep your arms straight, right? Your arms are nothing more than meat hooks for the deadlift. You're bending your arms on a deadlift, and that's a technique problem. And using straps isn't going to solve that. If you're still bending your arm with straps, you will still tear a bicep. You need to stop bending your arms. That's the bottom line. Like, it's just something you need to fix. Set up a camera or have a friend yell at you every single time that you do it. But do not tear a bicep. That is an easy 6 months out where you do not know that you'll ever come back the same. Do not risk it. Keep your arms straight and don't worry about tearing a forearm. That's not even an issue, man. But thank you very much for asking. I hope that helps. Next question. How quickly can a novice 3 months expect to increase weight with the deadlift? Literally every single day. Number one, you're not only getting stronger because you're doing things, but you're also, your body is learning how to do that movement. So it's just getting better at doing the movement. It's becoming more efficient at learning the deadlift. If you're only lifting 3 months, you should literally be getting stronger every single day for a very long time. If you have a good coach, that's going to last very well into the next couple months. And if you don't, then you're gonna stall out really quick and you need to change things up. However, when you're a novice, man, you should be adding weight constantly, constantly, constantly. Like, the best gains of your life are happening right now. Do not take them for granted because they never come back again. Right now, you need to be adding as much weight as you can. All right, and last question. How impressive really is a 3x body weight deadlift? It is very, very impressive. So I would say somewhere between 10 to 15% of the members at my gym can do a 3x body weight deadlift. All of them are at least state level champions, if not national level champions or world champions or world record holders or things like that. So you're talking about a very elite group that can do a 3x bodyweight deadlift. Like I said, I have a very strong gym that is focused on competition and strength, and we only have about 10 to 15% of our members are actually in that caliber of person. But it is 100% of the factors that I would consider in when I look at somebody, I'm like, dude, they're strong. A 3x bodyweight deadlift will always make me say, they're pretty strong. So guys, there you go. There is a deadlift specific Q&A. I absolutely love these specific Q&A things. I'm sorry I ran so long. I'm sorry there are so many distractions with the dogs and everything, but I tried to answer as many questions as I possibly could. It means a lot to me that you guys took the time out of your day to ask those questions, so I want to take time out of my day to make sure I responded. I either tried to online or to you. Again, almost all of these questions came from Instagram. So if you guys, for the future Q&As, want to be getting question answered, make sure you do it over on my Instagram, @NeverSate. I thank you guys so much. So cool that I have the type of support from you guys where I can ask for this type of thing. You guys can respond so greatly with such good, intelligent questions. Really, really cool. I am overwhelmed. I am humbled. Thank you guys so much. I will catch up with you later in the week. Until I do, guys, go out to something major, guys. Keep working hard. I will catch up with you soon.
So much talking.
Go out to something major, guys. Keep working hard, people. Be nice to each other, and I'll see you then.